So as everyone is sort of wandering in and getting themselves seated, I will go ahead and introduce our moderator for the last panel of the day. Professor Jed Shugerman is a legal historian who's widely published in law journals in addition to publishing a book on the history of judicial elections. He teaches at Fordham University School of Law, and he's graciously agreed to guide us through our last panel. So with that.
Great, thank you very much. So this is, I'm happy that this is the best panel of the day. I also might be a little bit biased. And it's all on new frontiers of bias, so I think it's only appropriate to disclose my own bias in this case. So I think I just want to start with a note before I introduce the panel here about one way to think about this this topic in a broader sense. So when I wrote the book, I wrote a book on the history of judicial elections to explain how America chose this very peculiar institution. And the way to frame it is that judicial independence as a concept is actually very historically contingent and changes. It's a very relative concept. The reason why judicial elections were adopted in the first place was because of a commitment to judicial independence. They were framed as a way not to make judges less independent. They were framed explicitly to make judges more independent. So how do we make sense of that? The question in the 19th century, as Judge O'Connor here mentioned about Ohio in 1850, was part of a wave of states that decided to change over to judicial elections. And the reason why they made that change was it was in the middle of an economic crisis in which half of the banks in the country folded, and eight states went into bankruptcy. And the blame was focused on the governors and legislators who had misspent and mismanaged the state's funds. But secondarily, the judges were blamed for not being a check on the other branches. So the argument was, in order to make judges more independent from whom? Independent from governors and legislators and a corrupt appointment process, elections would make those judges more independent, framed explicitly that way. So what I just want to note here is that judicial independence is a relative concept. Today we've been focused on the question of how to make judges independent from whom? From special interests. That's what recusal addresses, when special interests spend money. But I think this panel is going to look more broadly when we ask judicial independence from whom, or what kinds of bias that lead judges to be less independent. Some of these are very internal mental processes. So one way to think about it is that judicial appointments themselves have their own biases and their own corruption. So judicial selection is often a sense of relative judicial independence. From whom are we making judges independent? So one other way to think about it is, when do we have not relative judicial independence, but general judicial independence? Or we might put this as absolute judicial independence. And I'd simply suggest there are a couple points that came up earlier today. Judge Clark, for example, illustrated this, and I also believe this was part of the debate in the last panel among the judges, is that longer terms, not the selection of judges, but how long they serve, makes judges more independent. Right, because they don't have to worry, even if more money is spent on the front end, they're then more independent of feeling like they have to serve those interests if they serve a life term. So ironically, West Virginia, with the Caperton case, had huge amounts of money, but very long terms, right? Judge Benjamin actually served a 14-year term and had less to worry about for the next election compared to, let's say, New Jersey, which has appointed judges, not elections, but those judges are appointed to 7-year terms, so they face the politics and the special interests of reappointment much more directly than Judge Benjamin having to think about the special interest spending thereafter. That's one aspect. So that general independence helps us think about a couple of things. One is, when we think about judicial independence from special interests and also public opinion, we can think about the ways to address those issues more broadly, right? I think that's a different kind of question beyond recusal for special interests. And also another point is to simply say that there are other ways of selection methods. So simply to throw out one proposal or one way to look at the other methods of choosing judges is that it turns out that merit selection, when you study it closely, it winds up having not the same amounts of spending over the last 20, 30 years. Now, it's trending a little bit in the direction of more spending, but it is so far behind in terms of the retention elections, the unopposed yes or no retention elections you see, there really isn't even close to the same spending, even today, in these retention elections. But does merit selection really produce the best judges in terms of merit? You don't have to rely on that. That's not the explanation for this. I think there are two explanations. You know, for the lack of spending, if you don't know who you're going to be electing to replace that judge when you vote no, you're less likely to invest in that judge, right? It might be someone very similar. So special interests have less incentive to get a no vote if they don't know who the new judge is going to be. Now, it's true that Judge Blankenship, in the Caperton case, was maybe more focused on defeating Judge McGraw, but he at least knew that he had a supporter coming in, right? So that's one explanation, I think, for why merit selection is something that I'd like to throw out there as a solution to the problem of special interest funding that is a little bit broader than the recusal suggestion. But there's another angle, too, which is that in terms of being captured by a special interest, merit selection, whether or not it produces more meritorious judges, it still has a more pluralist way of choosing judges, because the commissions that nominate, that send a list to the governor, what happens is the governor gets a list of three names from a commission. That commission is drawn from various segments of the public. It has sitting judges, it has the ABA, it has representatives from the governor, it has representatives from the legislature. Well, each of those groups can be a veto on the crony, the Harriet Myers or the Abe Fortas, to pick a bipartisan example, who is really in the pocket of the governor or executive branch. In the same way, the ABA can be a check on the other groups, and other groups can be a check on the ABA. And so the person who winds up getting nominated or being sent to the governor doesn't have any one actor to thank for their job. So just to finish my big picture point, there are other mechanisms beyond recusal to think about promoting judicial independence from special interests, judicial independence from the other branches, and judicial independence from public opinion, and that I suggest is merit selection with yes or no retention elections, and most importantly, longer terms. Okay, so now I think we're going to get other perspectives that go from Caperton's next generation beyond the bank, or breaking the bank, breaking beyond the idea of the money here, to draw attention to other kinds of judicial bias and partiality, to look at other kinds of bias, and discuss recusal for reasons that go beyond campaign contributions and maybe other perspectives on how to make our courts more fair and more reliable. So first we have Debra Lynn Bassett, the Justice Marshall McComb Professor of Law at Southwestern Law School. She focuses her scholarship on federal litigation and legal ethics. And her writing regularly employs insights from law and psychology. And on her website, she talks about how much she loves doing research that combines theory and practice. And I think this panel is a good example of making that synthesis between theory and practice. Then we'll have her frequent co-author, Rex Perschbacher, who is the Daniel Dykstra Endowed Chair at UC Davis. He was dean of that school for 10 years, and he teaches in the areas of civil procedure, professional responsibility, and clinical teaching. Then we'll have Gregory Parks, who has a JD and a PhD in psychology. He teaches at Wake Forest School of Law. He didn't put this on the official. Maybe he didn't want to show all of his accomplishments. He's about my age, and he's already authored 10 or edited or authored 10 books. So that's amazing. And so Professor Parks is currently working on a book on unconscious race bias and law. And finally, Dmitry will speak. He's associate professor at the University of Maine Law School, and he has also published prolifically. He's a scholar and commentator on judicial ethics, judicial selection, and constitutional interpretation, and he's written a lot about Caperton and these issues. So I am very happy to serve as a moderator on this panel, because I think they have a lot more to say than I do right now. So without further ado, Debra.
Thank you, Jeb. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for staying to the end here. Many thanks to the Journal of Legislation and Public Policy for organizing this symposium, and to NYU, the ABA Center for Professional Responsibility, and the Brennan Center, of course, for sponsoring this symposium. One of the recurring problems in judicial recusal and disqualification is that a judge's belief in his or her own impartiality misses the point. Public confidence in the judiciary doesn't result from the judiciary's perspective of impartiality, it results from the parties and the public's perception of impartiality. And perhaps unfortunately, it is a very human tendency to have what's called egocentric bias, the ability to see bias in other people, but not so much in ourselves. This is one of the problems with having motions for judicial disqualification heard by the very judge whose impartiality is being challenged. And in addition to egocentric bias, judges' perceptions of their own impartiality also suffer from unconscious, truly unconscious motivations. Until the 1980s, most psychologists believed that attitudes, including prejudices, operated consciously, that individuals were consciously aware of their own biases and stereotypes. Therefore, psychologists relied on self-reporting to measure bias and prejudice. However, it turns out that we aren't consciously aware of all of our biases and prejudices. The human brain is continually bombarded with stimuli, and in order for the brain to function efficiently, it employs largely unconscious methods of organizing information, and it creates mental shortcuts to speed the processing of information. And that's generally a good thing, or the brain would be completely overwhelmed. One of the brain shortcuts involves distinguishing various objects based on features of the objects that then coalesce into patterns. That way, rather than having to stop and actually figure out each time from scratch what a desk or a lamp or a refrigerator is every time we see one, we come to recognize the general characteristics of those objects such that we know what they are, even when the style or the materials vary. The thing is that we have these organizational shortcuts not just for objects, but also for human beings. Over time, the brain learns to sort people into certain groups based on combinations of characteristics, such as age, and gender, and race, and role. The brain's sorting process includes the use of stereotypes, meaning traits that we associate with a category, and which develop from our experiences with others. Some of these experiences are direct, but most of them are vicarious, such as those relayed to us through stories, books, movies, media, and culture. The brain's sorting process can be helpful in some situations, but it can also lead to discriminatory reactions. The problem occurs when the brain automatically associates certain characteristics with specific groups, and it turns out that those characteristics are not accurate for all of the individuals within that group. For example, elderly individuals are frail. These implicit attitudes, attitudes of which we're not consciously aware and which operate automatically, include both stereotypes as well as an affective component, meaning an association between a group and an attitude. That attitude can be positive or it can be negative. Through a test called the implicit association test, psychologists have found that most people harbor unconscious biases in a variety of areas, including race, gender, age, and disability. Finding that people who believe themselves to be unbiased may nevertheless have unconscious biases and prejudices. The significance of this psychological research is what prompted the recent development of programs by the ABA Section on Litigation and the National Center for State Courts for judges to educate them about this phenomenon of unconscious bias. Unfortunately, however, the psychological literature has also consistently shown that at this point in time, in our current understanding of psychological principles, the ability to override unconscious bias is only temporary. At some point after the program or the workshop is over, the brain's automatic unconscious processes will kick back in. So self-awareness is a crucial, a very important first step. But it isn't, just one workshop isn't going to eliminate unconscious biases. And this supports the need, the absolute need, for alternative or additional decision makers when reviewing motions for judicial disqualification, rather than leaving the decision only to the challenged judge. Thank you.
Great, thanks so much.
Thank you, and thank you, Jed. Thank you, the Journal of Legislation and Public Policy. Thank you, the Brennan Center, and thank you, the ABA Center on Professional Responsibility. I hope I got everybody more or less right. I wanted to talk about bias in an international, breezy international style, if I could, today. So if we take a look at judicial recusal and disqualification issues internationally, we find the exact same issues as we have here in the United States, as illustrated in the Caperton case. For example, and I've got three plus examples of this, bias issues are reviewed generally from the perspective of the judge, not an outsider, even when using as a guide the appearance of impartiality, one of the ABA's standards. Second, the first level of review of judicial disqualifications nearly always resides internationally with the very judge whose bias is being challenged, with the unfortunate consequence that the challenged litigant is asking the accused to acknowledge his or her own bias, and that the next level of review, if best, goes to a court in which the challenged judge is either a member or otherwise familiar as an additional party, and therefore a problem. And I apologize to all the judges. I realize I'm going to insult everyone at some point here, so I'm apologizing in advance in the hopes, but not the expectation, that they'll forgive me. Third, no courts appear to take seriously the need to avoid the appearance of bias, and instead, in the United States and throughout the world, require using the perspective of a reasonable observer, or even the perspective of someone in the judge's shoes who's using criteria of what a fully informed, reasonable judge would understand. So throughout the world, the standards appear to be remarkably similar, requiring an unbiased, often even in quote, in which it may appear to a reasonable observer that the judge is unable to decide the matter impartially, as the only exception. So for example, the United Nations International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights several generations ago said, everyone shall be entitled to a fair and public hearing by a competent, independent, and impartial tribunal. And the United Nations Judicial Integrity Group in 2002 adopted what are called the Bangalore Principles of Judicial Conduct. They provide, quote, impartiality is essential to the proper discharge of the judicial office. A judge shall perform his or her judicial duties without favor, bias, or prejudice, and ensure that a judge shall disqualify himself or herself from participating in any proceeding in which the judge is unable to decide the matter impartially, or in which it may appear to a reasonable observer that the judge is unable to proceed in an unbiased fashion. Taking a quick look at some common law jurisdictions where it's relatively easier to do the research, in England, Canada, Australia, and South Africa, the experiences are roughly the same. In Canada, the apprehension of bias must be a reasonable one, held by a reasonable and right-minded person who is informed and right-minded member of the community who approaches the question with a complex and contextualized understanding of the issues in the case. In other words, like the judge. In the United Kingdom, similarly adopted a real danger of judicial bias versus the reasonable suspicion standard, and the House of Lords ultimately required the person must adopt a balanced approach to bias. Australia requires greater emphasis on perception of a hypothetical reasonable person in the apprehension of bias as perceived by the parties. And South Africa, which provides some distinction, there's a reasonable suspicion standard adopted, that is the perspective of the reasonable suspicious observer, but presumes that judges will approach the controversies impartially within a reasonable, objective, and informed person who would be on the correct facts, reasonably apprehend that the judge will not be an impartial or will not have an impartial mind to bear. What these standards tend to do is read out the ABA model rules standard requiring recusal when necessary to avoid an appearance of impropriety or when a juror's impartiality might reasonably be questioned. And we have to ask ourselves, if we're going to protect against what Justice Lippmann was telling us just recently, we need to worry about how the outsiders, the litigants in most cases, will apprehend the potential for bias, not the judges. So to protect against excessive, supposedly these standards are adopted, to protect against excessive disqualifications by devaluing the fear of bias by a litigant, any evidence of a crisis anywhere in the world that I know of is absent so far. But if you know, you can raise with me the possibility there's somehow a crisis of disqualification of judges occurring anywhere in our world. Thank you.
Great. Gregory.
Good afternoon. You all right? All right. I'm going to make sure everybody's awake. Thank you to the Brennan Center and to the NYU Journal of Legislation and Public Policy, especially to Sasha, Eddie, and Matthew for your hard work in putting together this symposium on Caperton and judicial recusal. It is indeed an honor and a privilege to be here with such distinguished jurists, academics, practitioners, journalists, and most of all, most importantly, law students. In some ways, I will piggyback on what my co-panelists had to say. The 1980s synth-pop new wave group, the Human League, and as recently as a few years ago, the biggest boss thus far, rapper Rick Ross, told us in song, "I'm only human." Such a concept is not striking. Most certainly these individuals are. But when it comes to talking and thinking about others in our society, judges in particular, some may suspect, including some judges themselves, that they are not mere humans, at least not in their professional capacity. In his book, The Common Law, published in 1881, Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes noted that the life of the law has not been logic, it has been experience. Some decades later in his work, Law and the Modern Mind, in 1930, legal realist Jerome Frank carried this concept a bit further when he observed that some judicial decisions might reflect such mundane influences as what a judge had to eat for breakfast. This notion seems laughable, but over the past several decades, research in the areas of social and cognitive psychology suggests that Professor Frank may have been on to something. People are complex. One's stated attitudes and beliefs often fail to align with one's actual thoughts and feelings. In experimental settings, for example, social desirability, the tendency of research study participants to reply in a manner that they believe will be viewed favorably by the experimenter, may serve as a motivational factor behind lack of candor in a study. In social settings, impression management, particularly saving face, may be a driving force for individuals. Indeed, people do lie. However, the assumption that human thoughts are entirely accessible to conscious awareness and that human behavior is largely governed by conscious agency has been severely undermined in recent years. People's expressed reports of their cognitive processes are often inconsistent with their actual judgments. Hence, shared cultural logics and psychological influences on judgment seem to operate wholly outside of people's heads and conscious awareness, so much so that social psychologists now contend that people rely on two distinct systems of judgment. One system is rapid, intuitive, subconscious, and error-prone. Another is slow, deductive, and deliberative, but much more accurate. The two systems may operate simultaneously, but produce contradictory responses. Moreover, the intuitive system can often dictate choice, while the deductive system may fall behind to search for rationales that align with accessible memories and understandings that the individual has about themselves. As a result, individuals may be unaware of one, the existence of a significant stimulus that could influence a response, two, the existence of the actual response, or three, that the stimulus affected the response. Putting this dual system to a test, social psychologists Timothy Wilson and Richard Nesbitt conducted a study in which they required participants to rate four identical pairs of stockings. 40% selected the stocking in the rightmost displayed position, while 31% selected the stocking just to the left of the most selected stocking. In essence, there was a position effect. Out of the 52 participants, 80 spontaneous responses were given for why they made their selection. None mentioned the position of the stocking as the reason for that selection. When the subjects were directly asked whether the order of the stockings might have influenced their decision, only one indicated that as a possibility. More recently, and specific to the topic at hand, federal magistrate judge in California, Andrew Wistrich, and colleagues conducted a study in which they found that the initial amount offered by plaintiff's lawyers in a pretrial settlement conference, whether it be high or low, created an anchor for how much trial judges would award in compensatory damages. Much of my personal work focuses on issues of race. Given that race remains such a contentious social issue, it serves as a catalyst for impression management, with individuals seeking self and others' perceptions that they are racial egalitarians. The problem is that anywhere from 75 to 90% of whites, approximately 60% of Latino and Asian Americans, and anywhere from 35 to 60% of African Americans harbor automatic, subconscious, anti-black, pro-white biases as measured by the implicit association test. These findings are based on small experimental studies as well as large national data sets. More importantly, subconscious biases are predictive of a range of behaviors, including the use of racially divisive language, judgments of perceived threat and hostility, guilt and innocence, and they are predictive of judicial decision making, especially where race is not a salient factor in the case. The point being, for the most part, when a judge makes racially insensitive comments, tells a racial joke, shares a racial email, or states a policy position that negatively implicates race, they should recuse themselves from a case where race can be implicated. It is not that they are racists per se, but rather likely to be influenced by automatic racial attitudes that they hold, or at the very least, give the impression that they cannot be impartial decision makers. I'll end on that note.
Great, thanks, Gregory. Dmitry.
Okay. Well, I usually tell my students not to try to make two big points in 5 minutes, but they're not here, so I'm going to try to make two big points. So the first one I want to make is, and this really builds off of what Greg and Debra said, and that's we're all biased. We all have biases. If legal realism has taught us anything, it's that the way we perceive the world depends in large part on our family, on our experiences, on our race, and our gender, on what we believe when we encounter new information. And as somebody who writes about judicial elections, I'm going to focus mostly on elected judges, but I'll talk about other kinds of biases that are out there. We've talked a lot about money today, and money's an easy target. It's an easy target because it's quantifiable. It's easier to find a solution when it comes to money. You can try to draw bright line rules about recusal for depending how much money you receive in a campaign or how much money is spent on you. But money is just one problem. I want to say there's at least two other problems. One is at least as important, as big, and the other one is much bigger. So the one that's just as big is the problem of judges promising, committing themselves to certain positions in the course of their campaigns. This was the issue in the Republican Party of Minnesota versus White case when I was a law student in 2002, where the court said judges have the right to announce their views. We don't have holdings that are promising to make certain holdings, but really there's not much of a difference between saying, my view is abortion is illegal under state law and I'm going to do everything I can to do it, versus actually promising to stop abortion, right? And so judges, oftentimes, if you look at current campaigns, oftentimes make announcements, expose their views, make commitments to rule in a certain way. And once you've made those promises, you better be careful about keeping them because the voters are going to hold you accountable next time. And so that's one big problem. The biggest problem, really, is the fact that judges who face an election have to keep the electorate happy to keep their jobs, right? And so we have lots of studies these days. I mean, for a long time, we speculated that judges might be biased in these cases, biased in favor of in-state interests, biased in favor of the political party that's in power at the time the election's coming up. Now we have the numbers to back it up. I mean, I feel like every month there's a new study showing that judges are biased in favor of in-state parties. that, as Justice Cobb mentioned last panel, they impose harsher sentences as elections get nearer, impose more death penalties. And so now we have those numbers. And so we know the judges are biased, right? And those are big, important biases that we really haven't talked much about that I think are just as important as money. And of course, elected judges are subject to the same biases, all the other biases that every judge is subject to. And don't forget, in Caperton, we had two other recusals. We touched on these earlier, right? One was based in friendships. If I had PowerPoint, you would see the you know, a justice of the Supreme Court on the Riviera with one of the parties to the case. Justice Maynard eventually recused, but that's a big issue. That's a harder one to regulate. I mean, we saw this in the U.S. Supreme Court with Justice Scalia and Dick Cheney going duck hunting together. How do you address that, those kinds of biases? So those are other additional biases. And of course, personal characteristics as well, right? That's the other big piece. One of my favorite recent studies, I think it was a couple of Harvard professors looked at judges with daughters, how they decide cases involving women's rights. Right, if you have a daughter or two daughters, you decide sexual harassment cases differently, sexual discrimination cases differently. What you had for breakfast, it might sound silly, but there have been studies looking at, I think, Israeli judges where they impose lesser sentences immediately after lunch. Right, they're less punitive. So all those things make a difference. We had an empathy debate with Justice Sotomayor's appointment, right, and where President Obama says empathy is an important piece. And Senator Sessions gets up on the floor and says, look, empathy is just a code word. It's about bias, right? You want a judge who's biased. So there's all these biases out there. They're very hard to identify. And what I want to finish with is maybe a pessimistic note. Keith Swisher opened today. He was the optimist. I'm going to make a pessimistic note, which is I don't think recusal is the answer. I don't think recusal can solve the problem. I mean, we know these biases are out there. And recusal is tempting, in part because there's seemingly no other solution, and in part because it seems so perfect at the time, right? You have a biased judge. If you can just get rid of that biased judge, that's the fix. And I want to say it doesn't work for at least a couple of reasons. So one reason is the one we've talked about, everybody seems to agree on. It's the fact that judges decide their own recusal motions. I think that's going to be easily changed. I actually wrote an article recently that procedure is unconstitutional, not just problematic, but actually puts the judge in deciding their own case. So if you're a lawyer, you can make that argument to be rejected by the court, I'm sure. But even if you have other judges making these decisions, judges like each other. They don't like recusal. Lawyers hesitate to bring these motions. It's almost impossible to create a true adversarial process, right? We think of recusal as any other motion, where you have two litigants getting together and filing a motion with a judge, but that's not what recusal is, right? Recusal is a dispute between a judge and a litigant. And so even if you bring it to another judge to decide that dispute, it's almost impossible, and maybe we don't even want to create an adversarial process where the litigant and the judge square off to decide whether or not that judge should be recused. And the final piece here, and there are a few others, but the biggest one here is if bias is institutional in the sense that elected judges are biased, and numbers seem to back this up, and of course not every judge and not in every case, but statistically significant, then every elected judge is biased. So recusal just can't fix that problem. You can't replace one elected judge with another elected judge when both of them have to face the electorate in the next case who's going to be concerned about, you know, the electorate's going to focus on how you decided each criminal case or how a criminal case has been spun against you, right? These campaigns are typically about who is the toughest on crime, right? So if you're a judge, you've got to be careful about those consequences. So that's why I think recusal doesn't work. And it's also inconsistent with the idea of elections. I mean, if we think about elections as, you know, giving the people a chance to decide sort of popular sovereignty, democratic values, decide which values they prefer, it seems odd to remove the judge who's made certain promises and commitments from being able to exercise those promises and commitments. So there's lots of problems here. I don't have a great answer, unfortunately, but I don't think recusal is the answer at all to fix this massive bias problem. I say in my articles that I think it's the biggest problem facing law and really all of law. My colleagues always say, yeah, you're just saying that to appeal to 2L Law Review editors to accept your articles. No, that's not the case. It really is, I think, the biggest problem facing law. And just focusing on elected judges, just as Breyer was quick that they decide 97% of all cases, the numbers seem to be pretty close to that. About 90-95% of all cases, all judging, is done by state judges, and about 90% of those are elected judges. So a lot of our work, and these are not sort of driver's licenses cases or bureaucratic cases. I mean, these are fundamental rights. They decide cases on U.S. constitutional rights, on voting rights, abortion law, same-sex marriage. These are key fundamental cases that are being decided by potentially biased judges.
Great. There's a lot on the table. I want to make sure we have plenty of time for discussion. But I wanted to start with a couple of questions to focus. Dmitry ended with the problems and not necessarily pinpointing solutions. But given that we've had several panelists focus on the problems of implicit bias when it comes to all kinds of features, just a couple notes. I mean, there was remember the Dahl study that was the focus of Brown versus Board of Education? Turned out it wasn't the most advanced social science, but it turns out it actually found that the doll studies where they gave white children and black children in the South white and black dolls and asked for associations with those two dolls, and early social science when it came to race and implicit associations, and found that both black and white children in Jim Crow South both had negative associations with the black doll and positive associations with the white doll. Turns out that those numbers were worse in northern states than in southern states. And here's another fun fact. The study was replicated recently, and those numbers are even worse today in 2014. So we also, one more note about that is that, you know, we've had some reference to Mazur and Banerjee's study in the papers about implicit bias, and I have given my students access to that study. I've asked them to look at it and to think when I teach tort law about the questions of bias, all kinds of bias. So given that lay of the land now, where we are more aware of implicit bias, at least as decision makers, what are the solutions? Debra, you've talked about in your writing education, mm-hmm. Trying to use those resources. Here we've been talking about recusal. Is that a solution? Is better judicial selection a solution? And maybe more elections, not fewer, maybe more accountability to the people, so that people who are held over from an earlier era and are not moving into the 21st century can be voted out of office. What do you think about those solutions to the implicit racial and gender bias?
I have a couple responses. One, remember, there's also part of the, I think it's from the ABA's section of litigation studies, of asking judges whether they were above average or not in detecting and deflecting bias, and 90% of the judges found that they were above average. And this is not a criticism of judges. This is us. This is human beings. This is the way in which we think about the world. Now, I think recusal is not the answer, but I don't think there's any better answer. That can be my non-answer. I think that there's some virtue in adopting regimes where there's more or less automatic recusal. Justice Lidman was talking about that in New York. If you're given a certain amount of money, you're going to not hear the case. That's that. Because that will grant, I would hope, over time, that would desensitize the judges to the fact that I'm not being accused directly. I'm just following the law. This is what I have to do. I'm out of here. I think those sorts of approaches that are more peremptory, and California, of course, uses a peremptory challenge for trial judges, those kinds of things would help.
Great. Right, but of course the peremptory piece doesn't work when it's implicit bias, right? We don't know it ourselves. It's subconscious. I mean, I think the best answer I can think of is to try to look for evidence of actual bias. And maybe it's educating the public. I mean, one of the articles I wrote is about giving the public more information on the ballot itself, so having more neutral evaluations about judges. If you find evidence that the judges, you know, not just sort of bias, I mean, there can be sort of subconscious bias that you don't act upon, but if you act upon it, somebody should be there to stop it. And who that somebody is, I think it has to be the people, right? I mean, they're the ones that are in charge here. And so either in the election context itself, whether it's a piece I'm working on right now is about the jury as a check on judicial bias, having more active roles for the jury. But those are the only possible solutions I can think of. You know, actually, I mean, we talked a lot about appearances, but here I think there's not much we can do with appearances. Here we actually have to find evidence that some judges are acting in a biased way, whether or not they have the implicit bias, if they're acting in a biased way, and have somebody step in and try to stop that.
One of the benefits of the research that they've been doing into the implicit association test and unconscious bias is the idea that by virtue of making people aware of the fact that they have these implicit biases, that educational component can help reduce, at this point, what they've developed so far has been a temporary reduction, but at least there has been a reduction in subsequent kinds of unconscious bias kind of taking steps forward. And the hope is that more, as we get more and more psychological testing done, they've been able to now extend from what started out as being a reduction of 24 hours was all it would last. Now they're up to at least months. And so hopefully over time they would be able to come up with something that of course would help reduce it altogether. But I think the educational component is absolutely crucial, because absent that awareness of the potential for unconscious bias, I think people are all too comfortable floating along thinking, who, me? I'm not biased. I can approach this case objectively. Think how often litigators use that in the juror context. You know, a juror who has said something and then the lawyer decides to try to rehabilitate them by saying, but you can be fair, right? Oh, yes, I can be fair. And so I think that by virtue of having the educational component kind of at least one piece in the arsenal, I think that that helps. And I agree that, you know, recusal disqualification is not an absolutely perfect approach, but I'd sure hate to think of where we would be without it. What would we really always have to come up with some sort of concrete proof of actual bias? I don't think we'd be comfortable with that either.
I sort of agree with those arguments. I mean, you know, I know the literature, and yes, you can reduce an individual's implicit biases by various methods, but the individual has to be motivated to want their biases reduced, right? So a judge that isn't interested in going to any training because they seriously don't believe that they're biased, or they believe that these are philosophical views that they have, and it's not a racial bias or gender bias or bias against LGBT individuals, creates a conundrum. I think that a diversification of the bench is a good thing. It can create some challenges in elected judiciary. But there is a theory called social tuning, which contends that individuals sort of aggregate to the, well, sort of two theories. One, aggregate to the middle, so if you have different ideas in the mix, then individuals might not be so extreme. The other is that, at least when it comes to race, individuals, whites who have black friends, having a black friend does help reduce your implicit bias, because you get to see a black person as a person and not someone on TV or in passing on the street. I do like the idea of recusal. The challenge is with implicit bias, there's not enough research to show how it plays out in various forms of behavior. But there is some research. So when we have a judge who makes racially insensitive comments, you could probably tie that to implicit racial bias at the very least, right? Even if the judge denies that they're racist. So if I can, I want to read something. February 20th, 2012, Richard Siebel, Chief Judge of the U.S. District Court for the District of Montana, forwarded a racially charged email about President Obama from his official courthouse email address. The subject line of the email read, "A Mom's Memory," and contained the following text. "Normally I don't send or forward a lot of these, but even by my standards, it was a bit touching. I want all of my friends to feel what I felt when I read this. Hope it touches your heart like it did mine. A little boy said to his mother, 'Mommy, how come I'm black and you're white?' His mother replied, 'Don't even go there, Barack. From what I can remember about the party, you're lucky you don't bark.'" Now, it's an interesting play on miscegenation, white woman, and a dog. But the usual play here is actually what you saw a lot in the election and post the second election, associating the president with various forms of non-human primates, right? The challenge here was Chief Judge Siebel. Response when called on the carpet was, "I received this email from my brother. It is indeed racist, so my brother must be racist, but I'm not. I simply forwarded the email." After Chief Judge McKee in the Third Circuit pressured the Ninth Circuit to do a closer review of other emails sent by Chief Judge Siebel, and revealed that he had sent many racist, homophobic, sexist emails, which underscored that even if he wanted to believe he is not a racist, he does harbor automatic anti-black and maybe anti-whole range of other people attitudes. Now, this wasn't an issue about recusal. But I sure as hell would hate to be a black man in front of this judge in a court in any kind of case. Luckily, he stepped down. And so I think, it's sort of pushing back a little bit on your contention, Dmitry, I think recusal could be useful in certain circumstances, though probably not as widespread as one might hope.
Yeah, let me just clarify. I love recusal. I mean, when I was in law school, I think it works in situations like that, and I think it's a tool we shouldn't abandon. I just don't think it's the answer. I think it solves the bulk of the problem. When you have a judge who writes racially insensitive emails, yeah, that judge should be recused. And in the campaign contribution context, in case of the Caperton, I think Justice Caperton should have been disqualified and should have recused. It's just whether or not recusal can really solve the bias, the core of the bias problem. And I don't think so. I mean, Caperton came out when I started writing about this topic. And when I was in law school, the White case came out where Justice Kennedy said, you know, recusal can be the answer to these problems. So for me, it was, you know, love at first sight with recusal. It's just, and I've written papers about it, I just don't think that when we get to the real main problem, which is about elected judges thinking about their job prospects, and elected judges making promises and commitments on the campaign trail that bias their decisions, I just don't see recusal as solving those problems.
Let me push on this a little bit more, because I think we want to distinguish between the cases of explicit racism, which happen but only are signifiers or only symbolic of how widespread implicit is, but people aren't aware of implicit. So I personally found it eye-opening when I took, and my friends took, both white and black, took the Mazarin Banerjee IAC, the implicit IAT
test.
And you have to hit buttons. So instead of just coming up with words loosely, they show pictures, faces, and then you have to, because of the faces you see and the words, you have to immediately respond with the hitting on the keyboard, either the left side of the keyboard or the right side of the keyboard, and if you don't answer it in half a second, it doesn't register. So it has to be immediate. So when I took this test and when others took this test, white and black, we were all surprised about how much we were racists, right? We all had negative associations with black faces and more positive associations with white faces, white or black. So it replicated the studies of the dolls. So here are just two suggestions for the panel. One is requiring all judges to take this test, right? Now, I'm not a racist. Well, it turns out you take this test and you realize you do have these biases. Just to push a little further, a modest proposal, then publish the results of those studies, right? And so you have an index of, well, which judges have the strongest implicit biases, and then those can be the basis for recusal or disqualification motions. So how about the brave new world?
Well, the first part is already being done. That's exactly what the program is that the ABA Section on Litigation and the National Center for State Courts is doing in their workshops and programs that they're offering for judges, for sitting judges, is they offer these workshops on implicit bias, and part of the workshop is taking the implicit association test so that they can see firsthand kind of how it works. And the reaction has been overwhelmingly positive. It's been sort of an, oh my goodness, you know, that I had no idea. And the judges have responded very favorably, think that this is really valuable information that they've learned. And just kind of a half step back, the creators of the IAT, Anthony Greenwald at the University of Washington and Maharam Banaji at Harvard, have repeatedly said, do not associate that. That doesn't automatically mean that you are a racist. It means that you harbor these biases. Maybe that's drawing a fine line in the, you know, but they don't want people to have of that idea out there, that just because they ended up with a strong race bias of some sort, they don't want that automatically translated into the person being a racist, perhaps for obvious reasons, but to make sure that people are more openly willing to hear that because of largely vicarious experiences, that's what they're seeing in culture, that's what they've experienced, that most of us carry these more negative associations with respect to race and gender and age and disability.
And I think, it's fair and probably unfair to say, judges are some of the toughest people to be in this position because they every day get people saying, you're great, you know, I love all your opinions. That's just the way in which lawyers in particular tend to interact with judges. And then for them to have to face something like, I'm a racist, what do you mean, is going to be very, very difficult. So I think judges have the hardest job of all in facing these situations. And I'm glad Dmitry is on the side of recusal, at least part of the time. As I say, I think more automatic rules would work better because they might eliminate some of the accusatory notions that are behind those. You're a racist, you know, you're biased, what do you mean? It'd be nice to have more automatic rules that knock people off and they adapt to that and then say, that's just the way it is.
Why don't we open it up to questions? Sure.
So thank you all for being here. My name is Debra. I'm a student here at the law school. My question for the whole panel is, I wonder if you have thought of whether the process of judicial selection has some effect on implicit political bias, not just issues of race, gender, et cetera, but also on things like the environment, abortion, or any other issue that very politically active people might have stronger feelings about.
Let me respond. Yes. why does the President of the United States choose the people on the U.S. Supreme Court? Why does the governor of our state, even California, the second time around governor, choose the people on that he chooses for the bench? Because of the way they know that they react politically, because of the voice, the steps they'll take. So I think there's no question that at the higher court level, certainly, maybe less so at the trial court level, that the people chosen are chosen for deeply political reasons. And it would be shocking to find them going contrary to that. I think we're just addressing things that come up in the course of their time on the judiciary where they may have an opportunity to step aside. So yes, people are chosen politically. Look, in my state, California, we haven't had a recent, direct recent history of judges being thrown off the bench because of their views. But we had a time in the 1970s, I think it was the late 1970s, when three members of the state Supreme Court were removed. The first governor, Brown, in his first incantations to put them on, maybe he was more careless then, he put them on the court. They voted against the death penalty every single time. They were pushed off the court through in a retention election. They were not retained. The people who were voting knew what they were going to get because the new governor, Duke Majorn, was very harsh. On law and order issues. The people who sponsored the campaign were largely business groups who really wanted a change in the law of another sort. I don't think there's any magical solution in the appointment process or the response process that'll fix these things.
Yeah, we had a similar situation in Iowa just a couple of years ago where there were justices who voted in favor of same-sex marriage and got voted out of office in a retention election, right, which used to be completely safe. Right, so undoubtedly, judges have to be conscious of what's going to get them elected, right? What's going to get them to keep their jobs? And I think the problem is even worse at the trial level, where you know as a trial judge that each one of your decisions could be used against you in the next election, and that could drive the electorate against you. And so that's why I get really cautious in cases that have high salience, which are usually criminal cases. Right? You've got to be cautious about how you sentence people, because if somebody gets out of prison and commits another crime, that's going to be what the next campaign is all about.
But judicial elections can be a red herring here. So let me take each of those examples and add another one. So in the example of Rose Byrd in California, if she were up for reappointment by Duke Majorn, he would never have reappointed her.
That's true.
You take the Iowa judges with Governor Branstad, who helped orchestrate the anti-gay marriage campaign, was involved with it. He would never have reappointed those three Iowa judges either. And Penny White, who has been a loud voice for reform and talking about her, she was a Democrat who was largely pro-death penalty on the Tennessee Supreme Court, voted in one case where there was a pretty strong procedural argument to vacate the death sentence, but still keep the killer in jail for the rest of his life. That one case she was a concurring opinion on, and she was tossed off the bench. Well, the governor at the time, Sundquist, said she should have known better. And no doubt, if it was up to the governor, he would not have reappointed her. And the legislature, they also would like to be governor one day. They would have cracked down on those three judges even harder. So it's not, again, I think elections, they're messy for a whole bunch of unique reasons, like with money being so direct. But the money is, the politics are still behind the scenes in appointments. The money is still behind the scenes, and in some ways it's scarier with appointments because of how the special interests are less transparent. There's less disclosure, right? It's automatically, basically the governor and the legislature are basically organized political action committees or the donor committees, because the judge doesn't get the money, But they know the governor of the legislature would be, and then we're going to be picking them or not picking them. So there isn't the same opportunity for disclosure. So in some ways, I think the election versus appointment debate obscures these other problems. Again, length of term is the thing I want to focus on the most. And a selection process that doesn't privilege any one body or any one actor, any one corrupt force, but basically uses pluralism to direct the corruption forces against each other so they all check the worst of the candidates so that they're left with at least more mediocre but less corrupt judges, or ideally better judges that are, through their merit, rise above the special interests, because everyone can only agree on, if they can't get their crony, they'll at least say, well, this person, even if they're not our candidate, they're the best candidate out there because they're the best at the rule of law, and we can at least trust that, even if we haven't grabbed them with our dollars, right? So I think we need to think about this in a more complicated way than simply elections are bad.
And Jed, can I just add one thing? There are a couple of notable positions where federal judges who are not subject to the retention election have been picked on. Constance Baker Motley, a long time ago here in New York, was picked on. Said, well, she's a woman, she's black, she hates whites. And well, I'm either going to be black or white. I'm either going to be a man or a woman. Now, maybe it's not that simple today. And then in California recently with the same-sex marriage cases, Vaughn Walker, who was widely accepted as probably a gay guy, voted to strike down the laws, to federal district judge, was then immediately accused of, and there was a whole hearing on his bias, that he was just doing this for personal gain, because then he could get married to his longtime lover. That was rejected, but you know, these accusations are made. So I do sympathize with judges. You make one, as you were saying, one mistake, just one, that's all it will take, and you can be booted off the bench in an election. I kind of like the non-election, long-term situation.
Other questions? Yes, right here.
My name is Hugh Gamble. I'm not an attorney, so forgive me if I use the wrong terms. But all the panels seem to bring up money at some point, and in many cases, dark money. And the desire, perhaps by the ABA, and especially some of the judiciary committees in the ABA, to have more disclosure. Has these committees weighed in with the SEC on putting on the calendar about public companies making disclosure? And if they haven't, should they?
I might just invoke that the panel's title is Beyond the Bank. And so it's beyond the jurisdiction of this panel to talk about the SEC and banking policy. Is that fair?
But Jed, yeah. The ABA for a long time had a whole bunch of rules about economic, you know, money is actually easier to deal with than all the things we've been talking about here, because, as I think my panelists were saying, because the ABA had a set of rules. If you had any economic interest in a case, you couldn't sit on the case, and those have been cut back a little bit now. But I think money turns out to be a simple thing. The kinds of biases we're talking about are really difficult.
Right. Other questions? Yes.
We have judges and we have people who know they're fair-minded, really know it. And then we have people who are fair-minded, but who will say, I think I can sit in this case, but I can understand if somebody else reasonably doesn't think so. Now, you talked about the subconscious. Mm-hmm. I'd like to suggest that the recusal does tend to surface things from the subconscious, to at least you use words to address them. But what do we know about that particular turn of mind that will see the other side and act upon it with a kind of understanding of the reasonable layman's view of the case?
What do we know, I'm sorry, in terms of where that line is between somebody who says, I'm not biased, but maybe they really are biased, versus someone who says, I'm not biased, I know I'm not biased, but I do understand where the perception might come from.
Some people get that way and other people don't.
Yeah.
And you train for that. Training.
I actually do think that in part that's a piece of what these current programs are trying to do through the concept of educating judges, sitting judges, to understand this phenomenon of unconscious bias so that they can get to the point where they can see, oh, and it's the program, although it invokes the implicit association test so that they can kind of see, you know, some of their own things, it's also going toward kind of generally reminding people about diversity and other kinds of matters so that they can help see more readily kind of where perceptions can differ and where it is that even though they may believe down deep in their hearts that they're not biased at all or that if they have some biases that they can nevertheless rise above those biases and act fairly. I do think the educational component is trying to help them see, well, you know, that sometimes those perceptions can exist nonetheless. So I think that's about the best answer I have. Maybe Gregory has a better one.
No, I would concur with that. I mean, I think individuals, judges being scientifically sophisticated helps them make that judgment, right? And the question is how many state courts are actually doing this kind of training? Not a lot. I know that I clerked on the Fourth Circuit and my judge, Andre Davis, he, you know, Duke has this LLM program for judges around empiricism and law. And I don't know if my judge finished his thesis yet, but his wife is always on me to get on him about it, so she doesn't have to. But that being aside, I think judges who are willing to take this information in and not resist it are probably more inclined. What's troublesome is the judges who believe that they're not biased, that no one can tell them that they're biased, whether at the explicit or implicit level across any range of categories, those are going to, yes, hard-headed ones. All right.
Great. On the side here.
Student.
Yeah. Oh, no, not
student. I actually work at the Brennan Center.
Oh. That's why I changed it.
I'd like to push a little bit harder on this thought that recusal could function in response to gender or racial bias. So one thought about recusal is that that judge is qualified to be a judge and can sit on a judge on cases, but just not this particular case. And if you had enough information to demonstrate that because of gender or racial bias, that judge should not sit on that case, aren't you really saying that judge should not be a judge at all?
I think that what's going on with the programs that the ABA is doing is the idea of just making them aware that could this be a factor? And I don't think they're trying to come out and say you are a racist, you are a sexist, you are, you know, an ageist, you know, you are, you know, somebody who discriminates always on the basis of disability. I think what they're trying to do is just educate them that these do exist, that these are within ourselves, and that by virtue of reminding ourselves, judges in particular, but all of us, if we all kind of remind ourselves that most of us do harbor these biases, and if we make ourselves more aware of that on a regular basis, that can help, doesn't eliminate, but it can help to mitigate that bias. And if indeed someone has risen to the level where they are not just having some of these unconscious biases, but they are actually actively racist or sexist or whatever, then of course, arguably, that person really shouldn't be a sitting judge. But that's not what this educational program is about. What this educational program is about is heightening awareness so that you will not so blindly walk into situations. You won't just assume, well, hey, you know, I'm educated, so therefore, how could I possibly be, you know, harbor any racist or sexist or other kinds of biases? It's more, it's an increased self-awareness. That's what it's about.
Yeah, I'd concur with that. I make a sharp distinction between being a racist and having implicit racial biases. Racist is a very high standard. You use the N-word frequently. Well, this gets complicated, and you're not African American around other African Americans, but you use it as an epithet, and you explicitly despise, say, African Americans, right? You're a member of the Ku Klux Klan. You're a racist, right? The challenge with implicit bias is that, especially around issues of race, so many people have them, right? Like the numbers I gave, 75% to 90% of whites, 60-some-odd% of Latino and Asian Americans, 35 to 60% of African Americans suggest that it is in the ether. It is in the environment that we all take in. And so to say that a judge cannot be a judge because they have implicit racial or gender or sexual orientation biases would mean we probably wouldn't have judges. And so the question is, what do we do then once we know that so many people have implicit automatic biases? To my co-panelist's point, we try to educate them. We hope for the best. We hope that they are actually interested in not being biased, that they will want to continue to do things that will militate against their automatic associations with racial categories, gender, sexual orientation, and positively and negatively valenced concepts and words. So I think that that's my point. I think you have to make a sharp distinction between a sexist, a racist, a homophobe, and someone who simply has an automatic preference or bias.
Great. Other hands? Anyone else? Here, right there in the middle.
Thank you. I just had a quick question. There was one type of bias that I don't think anyone has really touched upon, but I'd just be curious as to the panel's views on this. But it's a simple fact, I guess for lack of a better word, I'd call it a professional bias. The fact that, unlike in some countries where judges are trained from law school or shortly thereafter to become judges and to think, hopefully, as impartially as possible, the judges here, whether appointed or elected, all come from most part professional background, and they bring their personal experience, whether it's from the plaintiff's bar or from prosecutor's office or otherwise. And obviously, having been an advocate for many years, it's not a bad thing necessarily to have a bias in that context. How do you turn the switch off? And I was curious to see whether anyone has empirically measured the effect of those types of very obvious professional biases on the way cases get decided, because I would think it's probably one of the first things that people look at when they're doing research on a particular judge. What's their background, where do they come from, what's their point of view?
Yeah, and there's a, I forget the author now, but somebody will probably remember it. There's a great book that came out just a couple of years ago called The Judge-Lawyer Bias, which looks at how judges make decisions that are sort of in favor of the legal profession, try to make the laws more complicated, try to make lives better for lawyers. Maybe no.
I don't remember.
I can't remember the author, but it's a great book, and he's done a lot of sort of empirical work. There's sort of other kinds of biases that stem from that as well. I mean, I mentioned friendships. Right? I mean, that's what happens. If you have judges who come from the ranks of lawyers who are partners in the same firm, you're going to have a lot more friendships, and you have to try to figure out how you're going to deal with those kinds of biases that really result from the fact that judges didn't go to special judge school, have their own little community like it's common in Europe, but really just lawyers at heart.
Well, I would just, sort of following up on what we've been talking about, is educating judges, right? So implicit racial or gender bias is only one kind or two kinds of biases, cognitive biases that are out there. There are dozens of different types of cognitive biases, right? And so I know my mentor at Cornell, Jeff Raklinski, when he travels around the country, actually what he does is he goes to judicial conferences and he actually collects data and he gives a presentation. So the judges get some benefit, he gets a publication, right? And so, and what he does is he tries to educate them about cognitive biases much broader than simple implicit racial, gender, sexual orientation biases. So the Wistrich article that I just mentioned, it's with Chris Guthrie, dean at Vanderbilt Law School, and Jeff, who's at Cornell Law School. And that's simply focused on anchoring, how large numbers and small numbers sort of orient a person as to what kind of settlement figure they would come up with, right, or damage award they would come up with. So I think that there are individuals out there, I know that there are individuals out there who are actually trying to train judges around broader notions of what cognitive biases are and maybe how to address them, but I'm not sure if they focus on the specific one that you talk about.
One point to add is that I was making an argument for merit selection earlier, but one of the big downsides of merit selection is that a big player in that process is the State Bar Association. And so we're talking about replicating the profession. You give them a seat at the table to pick who gets sent to the governor on that list of three. So here are a couple more layers to that. So first of all, it turns out when they did studies of Missouri, this is one, it was often called the Missouri Plan because they were one of the innovators of it. They did studies that it was equally balanced between the plaintiff's bar and the big plaintiff's bar and the big defense bar, but there were no labor lawyers who got appointed, and surprisingly, no criminal defense lawyers. But they're out no matter what process we have in America. So that's one angle. The other problem with merit selection, at least in the past, is we're talking about how to counteract implicit bias. Turns out, at least studies of the 70s and 80s found that merit selection systems produced more white men for the bench, whereas the parties, whether Democrat or Republican, were more likely to nominate female and racial minority candidates, in part because they were more accountable to the broader public, whereas the bar still was largely run by white men. Query whether this has changed a bit as the bar has changed in the 21st century, but it certainly seems to lag behind society. So that's certainly, in my mind, a mark against the merit system, despite its other advantages. Some other hands. I saw your hand has been up in the back for a while.
Thank you. My name is Leonard Horowitz. I have like a broad question for you. It seems to me that impartiality and the appearance of impartiality are a bedrock of democracy. And we're having now, and it's probably happened for a long time, but I think it's more apparent now than maybe ever before, we're seeing important decisions being come with political bias. Panels, especially in the Health Care Act cases and the voter ID cases, are being decided on strictly political lines, which seem to me to be a very dangerous trend, and the Supreme Court, our Supreme Court as well, very dangerous trend in giving the public some confidence in the judicial system. I would wonder if you would comment on that, please.
I think that's true, personally anyway. Yes, our society is becoming much more politicized in every sort of way. We used to just worry about lawyers getting into everything, but now it's politicians, I guess, into everything. And I don't think there's a darn thing we can do about it from the bias point of view.
Yeah, I mean, part of the question is, we can describe lots of things as biases, but it's very hard to define what exactly we want to get rid of, and what is impartiality, right? And so I think we've sort of accepted the fact that partisan preference, political preferences, play an important role in judges' decisions. We've known this for a long time, sort of pretended for a long time it wasn't the case. But we've known for a long time now that judges' backgrounds and their political preferences shape how they view the world. And I think we've just come to the conclusion that that's not the kind of impartiality that we demand. In the Republican Party Minnesota versus White case that we've talked about a couple times, the court grapples with, you know, how do we define impartiality? Is it, and one of the definitions that Justice Scalia rejects is it just sort of complete open-mindedness, sort of clean slate, I'm accepting every argument? And he says, we don't want that kind of impartiality. We select judges based on their views. We want them to be educated, having made up their minds on certain issues. And just because, you know, I, Justice Scalia, have made up my mind on abortion, and you've seen that view in my decisions, that doesn't mean I'm not impartial. I'm still impartial. I just have a legal view that is shaped by my political and partisan preferences.
Right. Yes, right here.
I think it's interesting, I'm Susan Lerner, by the way, to look at the trial court level in Los Angeles over a period of time, starting with Jerry Brown in his first incarnation and going all the way through to now. There's a tremendous transition in terms of the sorts of people. LA for the trial court, and California in general, has a mixed system. It's appointed. Judges are appointed. Not from a panel, just generally, unless there has been no appointment when the election comes up for that particular seat, in which case it becomes an open seat and anybody can run. And my friends who were judges in Los Angeles pointed out that the big emphasis in the past, I'd say 20 years, is prosecutors are appointed to the bench there. And in fact, when you interview them for evaluations, and you say, why do you want to go on the bench? Some of them actually say, well, it's the next step in my career. I've done what I can in the DA's office. So you get that bias, but the election then ends up being a break on that process because people who have different backgrounds are able to run. So it isn't always the case that the elections work in a negative way. But just in response to your comment about Scalia's comments and the biases, and I'm forgetting the Ninth Circuit conservative judge who wrote a beautiful book about almost 10 years ago now, where he said the most important quality of a judge is the ability to continue to learn and grow on the bench. And don't we have a problem with some of the judges who have been appointed, particularly from my bias that come through the Federalist Society, who have their formed opinions and are not listening to the litigants and are not learning and growing on the bench, but rather putting everything into the box that they came with? And isn't that a problem?
Was that Alex Kaczynski who wrote that book?
No.
You know, on this question, so Linda Greenhouse just wrote a piece yesterday called Law in the Raw, and it was the point was that we've reached a new era where judges are really just politicians in robes. And my reaction is, welcome to the party, Linda. I mean, just look at the American history. I mean, they were literally politicians in robes throughout the entire 19th century. They were actually running from the bank. During Lincoln's presidency and right after, Lincoln's appointees were all people who had, this is sort of the book about the team of rivals that shows that that many of these appointments were specifically because they were rivals to Lincoln and he kept his coalition together, and many of them harbored presidential ambitions for the bench. Charles Evans Hughes resigned from the Supreme Court to run for president. So and so they were deeply political in the 19th century and deeply biased in the 19th century, obviously, as well. And they were, the Supreme Court was attacked for being political through the Lochner era and through the New Deal era. And it was always on the conservative end until it was deeply political on, you know, I liked the decisions, but they were political. Earl Warren was a politician who only got on the Supreme Court because he otherwise might have defeated Eisenhower for the next nomination. So it's a proud tradition in America, unlike in other countries, to put politicians, to appoint politicians on the bench. So whether we have elected judges formally or politicians appointed, it's deeply in the American judicial fabric. Okay, so that sounds negative. It turns out Europe, we're talking about, Rex talked about European judges and why they don't talk about the appearance of bias as much. It's, well, because they're bureaucratic functionaries. They're trained, I mean, do we want the European system where if you get the right grades coming out of a European law school, you're selected to go from, you know, college right into judge school without doing anything else with your life, and then you're literally a self-promoter. I mean, you know, academics do that too, right? But they work their way up. They promote themselves up without ever meeting a non-judge or non-lawyer. And so Europeans haven't exactly gotten the right balance either. But somewhere between the two may be a better meet. Yes, go ahead.
Yes, I think that two barriers to exposing judges' biases is, number one, the judge's ability to alter transcripts of the hearings, and secondly, close courtrooms for, although in New York it's supposed to be open courtrooms, that's not the case all the time in Queens family courts. And I think those are two barriers.
And on the second piece, I just want to say, I mean, I agree that, you know, more openness is part of the answer, right? More exposure to the public. Jocelyn Simons, who I think is here, who's a fellow at NYU right now, she wrote a great piece that recently came out about, you know, having the public, courtroom visitors, participants, being able to be more exposed to what's going on, a survey check on judges. That's part of the answer. I mean, part of what I've been thinking about is, you know, how do you get the public more involved and educated about what it is the judges are actually doing, and not be able to sort of hide it behind a cloak.
I think that's the full time for our panel, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, great. Any other questions?
He had his hand up.
Oh, go ahead.
I wanted to follow up on some of the white and whether there's been any studies relating to this as it applies to judges. I think there have been some as it applies generally, but you know, psychologically, once a person announces some type of position, even if they don't commit to it, which is sort of that line in white, isn't it, or have there been studies that say it's more difficult for the individual to change or be open-minded? Has any of that been done in terms of judges who have announced something in a campaign and then been confronted with a similar case and stayed in the box, as the commenter over there said? You know, have we created, has white created a whole new set of biases that didn't exist? Because now once you've announced, you're on the record and you can't then be more open-minded. Yeah. Are there any studies, anything you can talk to on that?
Boy, so I don't know if there are studies done with judges. I mean, there's lots of social science studies that look at, you know, making previous commitments or being stuck to those views. So that has been done, but I don't know if, I haven't seen a study done with judges on that. But of course, the majority in that case actually rejects that reasoning. The majority says, look, we as judges, sometimes we've committed ourselves in previous opinions, sometimes we've committed ourselves in books that we've written as academics. And so Justice Scalia, the majority, says, it doesn't really matter, right? Just because we've announced our views on something, that doesn't mean we're biased, even if it sort of suggests that that's what we believe.
But is there a difference between doing that publicly on the campaign trail versus in an opinion,
yes,
or in a law review article?
I would think so. And I think Justice either Stevens or Ginsburg in dissent says that there is a difference. And in fact, if you look at federal nomination hearings, there's a reason why we don't say anything, right? We don't say anything useful because we're worried about how that would look, but now you're letting judges do it in state courts, and what that really means, when you let them do it, you make them do it because you're competing against others who are doing it, or you got questionnaires coming to judges that say, what are your views, and you have to answer them. So I think you're right, there is a difference, but the court rejects it.
I mean, this is part of the point, and the white, you know, both Kennedy and O'Connor say, if a state chooses judicial elections, you're going to have people campaigning in those elections. That's what you get with elections. And so the downside is people make these campaign statements, and some would say about democracies that you'd actually hope that people would actually have some stickiness to the things that they say on the campaign trail and that anchor them in. I think that's wise. I think if it's uncomfortable for judges to be making promises or to be making campaign statements or to be asking directly for money, there is a plausible view that says that's what comes with elections. So if you don't like it, then let's see elections in full, and then the public can either take them or reject them based upon what the downside.
Judicial elections unconstitutional.
Some have argued that.
Yeah, I think the point about federalism is to say that the public should at least be able to see them in one way or the other and then make that choice. Yeah.
So we have just one last speaker today who needs very little introduction, but I'm going to give an introduction anyway. He's currently dean of the law school here at NYU, where in addition to captaining the ship, he teaches constitutional law and some other subjects. And I actually learned yesterday that he was the professor of one of our panelists when he was at Cornell as well. So we're pleased to play a part in this sort of intellectual family moment, I guess. So we're very honored to have Dean Morrison here to make some closing remarks, and I'll turn it over to you.
All right. Good to see you. Hi, everybody. So thanks for being here. I just have a few quick remarks by way of closing. I'll say this is one of those days when I'm both thrilled and a little bit unhappy about being dean, and for essentially the same reason. Thrilled to be part of a school that puts together events like this, that brings together a terrific journal like the Journal of Legislation and Public Policy and the Brennan Center and the ABA Center for ABA's Center for Professional Responsibility. That sort of collaborations like that that involve our students, our great research centers, and leaders of the profession is what this school does so regularly, and it's part of what makes this an exciting place. Sad because the dean's job prohibited me from actually being here to enjoy all of this, so I'm sure it's been a terrific day. This issue of judicial bias and recusal is of deep importance, as you all know, and it's in many ways surprising how unstable the positions are on this issue, given how old a democracy we are. And so that, if nothing else, certainly underscores the importance of today's symposium. So thank you to the journal for bringing it together, and for all of you for being part of it. Thank you to the speakers, including my former student, for being here. Again, I'm just thrilled that we were able to put on an event like this today. Thank you all. That's it.